name is David Goins. For those of you who might not know, if you're a guest here, I'm the director of worship and music here at the church, and the CD is still playing, Rusty. And I heard voices in behind. I want you to feel welcome, and I hope that you are having a good night and especially making new friends. We want you to know that we're glad that you're here, and we hope that tonight you leave a little bit changed and inspired to go do something and to make this Advent season something special for you and others around you. I'm going to, at this time, start our program, which starts with our adult handbell choir under the direction of Mr. Roy Nance. Will you welcome them?
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm so pleased with the excellent work this group has done. We practice 1 hour a week. The last couple of weeks we have scheduled an extra rehearsal on Sunday, but it's just a wonderful group, and we're so pleased to have them share it on the program tonight. The next next piece we have for you is a piece from Mannheim Steamroller. Chip Davis is the composer for that group, and this is one of the pieces that they recorded a number of years ago, Traditions of Christmas. Thank you very much. This next piece was a stretch for the handbell choir, but it was a major stretch for me. We had not played anything in the style before. Blue Christmas has a little swing to it, a little beat that you do not normally hear from the handbells, and it incorporates the sounds of the choir chimes as you've heard those previously in a couple of the pieces. But hope you enjoy Blue Christmas. Thank you very much. Our next piece is a wonderful arrangement of Patapan. It has a lot of rhythmic things going on. You'll see the ringers playing the bells with mallets. There will be a lot of the choir chimes, and especially happy to have those. We purchased a third octave of those this past couple of months. It's added a lot of depth to that kind of sound. And then we feature Catherine Clements. I mean, Catherine Woolhams. Where is she? Catherine Woolhams. Okay. There she is, Catherine Willems. And then our resident percussionist, David Goins. We would like to close our portion of the program with a beautiful setting arranged by Betty Gurry. Betty was a good friend of mine, wrote a number of pieces for handbells for the American Guild of English Handbell Ringers. It's been my pleasure to work with her a number of times several years ago. We're delighted to share with you to close Silent Night.
I think it's beginning to sound a little like Christmas. Next up is, real quick, before we start our play, we're going to let you listen to O Tannenbaum as played by our youth band. Every week we get together and play Christmas carols, and we've got a good one for you. I expect you to sing along and know all the words. Just a joke.
Church, we're glad all of you are here tonight. My name is Phil Hill, pastor here at First Church, and it is an honor to welcome you to Advent through the ages. Tonight, as we get started, a couple of housekeeping items. First, check around, notice where all the exits are. Pick yourself out two exits, just in the case of the unlikely situation that we might need to evacuate. We don't plan on doing that, but it's always nice to know where you might need to go. It is a great honor to be able to have you tonight, and we want to dedicate our program tonight to the glory of the Lord, and so let us pray together. Mighty and loving God, we thank you for gathering us here tonight, and we pray that what we do in this place will truly glorify your name. Thank you for literally the hundreds of people who have worked so hard to make tonight possible, and we ask your blessing upon us now that we will grow in our faith and that we will celebrate this special Christmas together. And now, Lord, without further ado, we give you ourselves, and we pray that what we do in this place truly pleases you. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, without further ado, I want to introduce to you the Advent Through the Ages, original work by Greg Hardison and our own David Goins, and as they would say, and a lot of others. But it's a great opportunity for us to see the talents and gifts of our great church, and so Advent through the ages.
Let me set the stage for you. It's the first week of Advent, November 28th, 1858. It's a time of hope. Among those experiencing this new beginning for the Methodist Church here in Frankfort is the Taylor family behind me. There is indeed a vibrant feeling of hope in the air. This is the very first celebration of Advent here in the new sanctuary. The church has found a permanent new home, and it's a place of beauty. It's a place of inspiration, and it will last for generations. This new home is set in a growing church right here, so comfortably close in the heart of the city, which is filled with people who are shaping the destiny of the entire state. This year saw the very first of the Lincoln-Douglas debates, the start of the Pikes Peak Gold Rush. The whole country is ready for change.
Branches.
Come along.
Yay.
Have a seat.
You know, I think that we need to move that tree a little bit to the left. That's much better, yes. Yes.
Wasn't the sanctuary beautiful tonight after the hanging of the greens? I never thought that we would be in the new sanctuary by Christmas, but Reverend Rand had no doubts, and there we were. Isn't that wonderful? And to think that just 2 years ago, our sanctuary, where our sanctuary is, was a livery stable. That's very appropriate for Christmas, isn't it? Because Jesus was born in a stable.
I hope this sanctuary lasts for 100 Christmases and isn't lost to fire as the last one was. It's incredible that we were able to acquire this land and build this wonderful house of worship. But you know, I don't think it could have possibly been accomplished without the benevolence of Philip Swigert. Wow. Mm-hmm. To God be the glory.
Yes. Well, I hope it will be a place where our members can come together in peace and love. I'm reading in the Kentucky Yeoman newspaper here. I'm worried about our country. It says that some of our countries, our states, are thinking of leaving the Union. And if that happens, that's over the slavery issue, it could result in a civil war with sons fighting sons and brothers fighting brothers. That would be a terrible thing for our country. But enough to talk about war. Let's enjoy the evening, enjoy each other. Dancing and music always makes me feel better.
Me too.
Children, could you all get together a song and do a dance, maybe a Christmas reel or something? I'd join you, but my dancing days are behind me now.
Go on, do it if you can.
Try it.
That'd be cool.
Last, it truly is Advent. What more perfect time to be filled with hope, to wait upon the Lord, knowing that Messiah truly will come. That is hope.
And the Apostle Paul writes, what is written in the past is written to teach us, so that through encouragement and endurance, we too might have hope.
The prophet Isaiah reminds us also that we should hope in the Lord and he will give us strength. We will soar like wings on eagles. We will run and not grow weary. We will walk and not be faint.
Here's to hope for the future years. Let's light the Advent candle for hope.
mass of wreckage, tanks and guns, marks the wake of Field Marshal Rommel's flight across the desert. Nazi planes blasted on the ground and in the sky lie half buried beneath the hot and shifting African sands.
Sunday, December 6th, 1942. It's the first anniversary of the bombing of Pearl Harbor. It's the second week of Advent. We are a country at war. Sales of new cars are banned to save steel. The first American soldiers arrive in Northern Ireland to begin fighting in Europe. President Franklin D. Roosevelt signs an executive order directing the internment of Japanese Americans and the seizure of their property. We are reeling from the news of Bataan, Midway, and Guadalcanal. We are fighting in the Pacific. We're fighting in Europe, North Africa. It is truly the second unthinkable world war. Everyone has loved ones involved in the war effort. Eager young men are signing up and shipping out. Here at home, we cheer them on. For love of country, they march away.
I tell you, Mary, I'm just sick and tired of reading the newspaper. Nothing but bad news. I can't take it anymore.
What's wrong, Joe? You haven't been yourself for days.
I'm feeling guilty. I feel like I'm a horrible fiancé. All we've done since we've been together is travel from town to town to town. And finally, we're back here in my hometown, against your will. For what? We live in this crummy place. It's practically a stable. We're poor. And who knows when or if we'll ever get married.
You haven't been a horrible fiancé, and you know, we're just going to have to be patient. We'll get married eventually. There's some new nice houses down at Thornhill we could look at, or maybe an apartment down by church. Speaking of church, this banner that I'm making is going to go with all the other stars that are hanging in honor of the people who are serving in the war. It'll help to remind me of you while you're off wherever you are. And it'll remind me while I'm saying my prayers to ask God to keep you safe until you get back.
If I get back. I tell you, Mary, I'm sad and I'm lonely.
You know, we're not the first ones to have to tough it out. Not the first ones to be poor or suffer for unreasonable reasons. Or for raising a child out of wedlock.
What? What are you going to do? What are people going to say?
Don't worry. I've spent a lot of time thinking about and praying about this, and God has told me He is with us. It'll be all right.
God is with us. I'm glad He's with us. Oh my gosh. You're right. Ye of little faith, God is with us. He's going to be with us. Look, I was gonna give you this on Christmas Eve, but I want you to have it now. Merry Christmas. I love you.
And I've already been given the best gift, the gift of love. In Luke, scriptures say, "For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word."
Bye. 1969, okay. Walk across the USA. It's another year for me and you. Another year with nothing to do. It's another year for me and you.
Another year with nothing to do. The year was 1969, and our nation had just survived the summer of love. Richard Nixon was our president. Opposition to the war is still raging among our youth nationwide. The Woodstock Festival is held in upstate New York. Meanwhile, down in Memphis, Elvis records Kentucky Rain. At last, the first troops begin to officially leave Vietnam. Gasoline was 36 cents a gallon. Apollo 11 lands on the moon, and Neil Armstrong utters his immortal, "One small step for man." We mourn Martin Luther King Jr., and his death accelerates the groundswell beneath the civil rights movement, and it shocks a nation into re-examining peace in a much broader sense. We chant for freedom. We chant for equality. But only a few seem to know where to turn for strength and wisdom to achieve it. A swarm of balladeers and folk musicians provide the soundtrack to this time of change, the emotion, the rhythm, the melodies, the tempos of this era. Provide marching music that inspires and guides and motivates.
Protesting in December? What's wrong with these kids? Shouldn't they be out singing Christmas carols or spreading Christmas cheer? If only a man could get a little peace to read the newspaper.
Well, Dad, if you would worry less about whether your stock prices are going up or whether your crude oil prices were going to allow for your cushy retirement, then maybe you could be a little more sympathetic to the cause. We have a war going on last time.
All right, that's enough. There's a lot of horrible things going on in the world today, and this war has made this year tough. But let's not forget some of the good things that have happened too.
Astronauts! You know, if we can put a man on the moon, think of all the ways we can find to live together in peace instead of always fighting each other.
Exactly. That's what Dr. King always stood for. We mustn't give up hope for a peaceful community or a peaceful world.
You know, didn't Martin Luther King have a march or rally right here in Frankfurt? I was a little girl then, but didn't you meet him?
Well, I did march with Dr. King to the Capitol, but I didn't actually get to meet him. I'll never forget the day we all met at the corner of Capitol Avenue Street, and we marched all the way up to the Capitol. Hey, Alex, you know the famous baseball player Jackie Robinson? He was there too. He and Dr. King had a private meeting with Dr. King, or with Governor Combs, about civil rights.
Right. And Fontaine Banks was there, too. You know Mr. Banks. We go to church with him. He sits at the end of the, at the back of the sanctuary on the, in the right pew. He worked for Governor Combs back then, and he, Dr. King, Jackie Robinson, and Governor Combs all met to discuss Kentucky's role in the civil rights movement. You know, I never told him, but I was really proud of Fontaine's role in all that.
What your father's trying to say is that we're very proud of our church's involvement for the movement of equality and peace. We're proud of you too. Your Christ-like concern for others is needed very much, especially at Christmas time. You can't let those who are in need suffer. You mustn't let their light go out.
Light one candle for the Maccabee children, with thanks that their light didn't die. And light one candle for the pain they endured when their right to exist was denied. And light one candle for the terrible sacrifice justice and freedom demand. And light one candle for the wisdom to know when the peacemaker's time is at hand. Don't let the light go out. It lasted for so many years. Don't let the light go out. Let it shine through our love and our tears. Don't let the light go out. It's lasted for so many years. Don't let the light go out. Let it shine through our love and our tears. And light one candle for the strength that we need to never become our own foe. And light one candle for those who are suffering pain we learned long ago. And light one candle for all we believe in. Let anger not tear us apart. And light one candle to bind us together with peace as a song in our hearts. Don't let the light go out. It's lasted for so many years. Don't let the light go out. Let it shine through our love and our tears. Don't let the light go out. It's lasted for so many years. Don't let the light go out. Let it shine through our love and our tears. What is the memory that's valued so highly? We keep it alive in that flame. What's the commitment for those who have died? We cry out they have not died in vain. We've come this far, always believing that judgment will somehow prevail. This is the burden, this is the promise, and this is why we will not fail. Don't let the light go out. It's lasted for so many years. Don't let the light go out. Let it shine through our love and our tears. Don't let the light go out. It's lasted for so many years. Don't let the light go out. Let it shine through our love and our tears. Don't let the light go out. It's lasted for so many years. The light go out, let it shine through our love and our tears. Don't let the light go out, it's lasted for so many years. Don't let the light go out, let it shine through our love and our tears. Don't let the light go out, don't let the light go out, don't let the light go out.
In 2 Thessalonians 3:16, it says, "Now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace at all times and in every way. The Lord be with all of you."
We long for the end of war. We long for peace.
As a nation, once again, we come together asking, "Come, Jesus, come again, Prince of Peace."
Is today. The time is now. And with modern technology, we should be better connected now than ever. Or are we?
Have you seen the news today?
Well, yes. Why?
Well, I can't believe what's happening in the world. Things are crazy. I'm going to have to post about this on Facebook.
Dad?
Yeah.
Dad!
Uh-huh.
Dad!
What?
Put the iPhone down and help us.
Yeah, but have you seen this?
Yeah, but what are you going to do to help?
Help?
I'm helping by volunteering at the soup kitchen.
Oh.
And our Sunday school class is putting together a Christmas benefit for teens.
Oh, well, wow.
The youth is gathering canned goods for the community.
Wow. Well, you know, with all these people, why do you need my help?
Dad, let me put it this way. Mary Jesus' mom was my age. Would you turn me away?
You know what, Hannah? I never really thought about it like that before.
So, what are you going to do?
The date is today. The time is now.
The scripture in Luke 2, beginning at verse 21, says, after 8 days had passed, it was time to circumcise the child, and he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And when the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what was stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. And guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared for the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. And then Simeon blessed them and said to the mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and the sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age, having lived with her husband for 7 years after her marriage, and then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped there with fasting and prayer night and day. And at the moment she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. Mary and Joseph, they presented Jesus as was the custom of their faith. It was a day when Simeon and Anna, totally unrelated to Mary and Joseph, saw in the baby Jesus that he was the Messiah. Do people see the Messiah in us? Do they see Christ in our worlds, in our words, in our actions? Do people truly see the love of Christ, the newborn King, in us? You see, Christ's greatest desire is to live through us. And today, 2,000 years after Mary and Joseph's presentation of Jesus in the temple, each new day provides us with the opportunity to present ourselves in service for God and to make confirmation that the Holy Spirit dwells in us to do God's kingdom work right here in this place. Throughout the ages, this great church, God has equipped those who chose Christ to fulfill God's purposes. It started out long before the invention of the automobile and the airplane, long before the internet and cell phones, long before antibiotics and microwave ovens. It began at a time when our nation was brand new. It began as our great, great, great grandmothers and grandfathers fell to their knees and they prayed for God's almighty strength, vision, and direction for their future. The church grew, and it became a beacon of light here on the banks of the Kentucky River. The church's doors were open to all. It was a place of refuge for those settling down and for those passing on through. It was a place of assurance that no matter what life brought to the people, of this area, the one constant was a loving Heavenly Father who offered amazing grace and salvation for all. As Mary and Joseph offered their sacrifices of two young turtle doves in accordance with the law of their faith here in this church, over the last 225 years, people have offered their own sacrifices they made and continue to make today. Commitment through their prayers, their presence, their gifts, their service, and their witness. Today is the day. The time is now to continue in even greater ways the kingdom work of our Lord in this place. And as God offers his greatest gift to us through the Christ the child, will you join me as we offer ourselves, our whole selves, in response to what God has done?
Saving one.
We pray, Holy God, that in this moment we will recall what you have done for us through Christ. We light our Advent candles. We await the birth of the King, our Savior and Lord. May we grow in joy and hope, fall on our knees and commit ourselves to you. Thank you, O God, for your blessing for our young people tonight, for these presentations. And now as we move to sing Christmas carols, we pray, Lord, that our hearts be warmed and that we give you our whole selves. In the name of Christ we pray, amen. My friends, we invite you now to stand and move through the exits to the sanctuary for part two of Advent through the ages.
One, two, ready.
Shout for joy, for the Son of God is the Saving One. He's the Saving One.